Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Armies of Daylight by Barbara Hambly, narrated by Sharon Freedman. Prologue. When the wizard Ingold crossed the void between worlds to save the infant Prince Tyr from the destruction of Gay, Gil Patterson and Rudy Solis tried to help him. But one of the monstrous, evil dark crossed behind him, and they were all forced to flee back to the world of magic from which the wizard came. It was a world where magic worked, and where the loathsome dark were destroying humanity after having lain almost forgotten in underground lairs for 3,000 years. And it was a world where the only hope for mankind lay in the distant ancient stone keep of Dare, built to resist the previous ravages of the dark. The king had fallen in Gay. Now, Chancellor Alwyr was the regent, as brother to young Queen Minalde. Vying for power was the Bishop Giovannin, fanatic leader of the Straight Faith. And both Alwyr and the bishop feared Ingold. The road to the keep was a hell of cold and danger, with both the dark and the barbarian white raiders taking toll on those who struggled through the freezing mud. But Gil found herself accepted as one of the guards. Rudy won the love of Minalde and discovered that he had wizard powers. He became a student of Ingold. Once the remnant of humanity was established precariously in the keep, Ingold and Rudy set out for Quo, the city where the wizards ruled and protected all their ancient lore. There had been no word from that city, and no magic of Ingold's could reach through the veils of illusion guarding it. But when they reached Quo, after 2,000 miles of marching through hardship and danger, they found the city in ruins. The dark had been there. Of the wizards, only Lohiro remained to meet them, and Lohiro was possessed by the dark. In a bitter struggle, Ingold managed to destroy Lohiro. Ingold sent out a desperate mental summons for any wizards of any degree of ability. Then he and Rudy began the long struggle back to the keep. During their absence, Gil had used her training as a scholar to investigate the old records, looking for some clue as to how the ancient Dare of Renweth had defeated the dark. Together with Minalde, who had a touch of the mysterious memory of past events that was supposedly inherited by only a few men, she found the ancient workshops of the wizard engineers who had built the keep. And she found artifacts of all kinds, most without apparent use. When Ingold and Rudy returned, they found a ragtag assembly of wizards, half-trained witches, and village healers waiting to become the wizard's core under them. Ingold realized that the crystals Gil had found were the ancient source of artificial light. And Rudy seized upon a collection of parts, which he assembled into a flamethrower, a possible weapon against the dark. Alwyr used the discovery as an excuse to determine that the wizards must spy out the nest of the dark at Gay. Ingold, knowing the folly of the plan, but unable to deter Alwyr, began trying to create a cloaking spell that might protect the wizards against the dark. Part 1. The Question and the Answer. Chapter 1. The night was still. The wind that had beaten with such violence down the ice-locked mountains to the north had fallen at about sunset, to an uneasy murmuring in the dark pines that filled the twisting veil of Renweth. By midnight, even that had ceased. The black branches hung motionless from one end of the veil to the other, slowly furring with frost in the deepening cold. A man's breath barely visible in the soulless glimmer of the few remote and haughty stars would hang like a diamond cloud about his face or freeze in white hoarfrost to his lips. In that piercing cold, not even the wolves were abroad. The silence ran from cliff to lightless cliff, an almost tangible property in that frozen and desolate world. Yet, beneath the dark trees, something had stirred. Rudy Solis was sure of it. He glanced behind him for the fourth time in as many minutes, fear creeping along his spine and prickling at the nape of his neck like tiny teeth. Yet he saw nothing there, only the thin sheen of starlight frosting the unmarked snow. He looked back to the darkness of the trees. He stood some 50 feet from the forest's edge, his shadow a misty blur on the old broken snow around his feet, his breath a tiny smear of steam against the darkness. Even wrapped in the thickness of his buffalo hide coat, he shivered, though not entirely with cold. He knew that it would be warmer in the protection of the forest, and look as he would, he could sense no movement there. It was undoubtedly perfectly safe, and sheltering there would be a damn sight more intelligent than standing in the open listening to the ice crystallize in his lungs. But neither hope of heaven nor fear of hell would have induced him to seek the shelter of those shadowed woods. A wind touched his face like a clammy, seeking hand. It took all his strength not to whirl, to face the unseen foe. But he had been told not to run. In the open ground of a still mountain night, flight would mean instant death. The cloaking spell that covered him, like all cloaking spells, depended upon diverted attention. The wizard who used one must do nothing to call attention to himself, lest the illusion fail. And in any case, Rudy knew that no human being could ever hope to outrun the dark. "This is stupid," he told himself desperately. What if Lohira was wrong? Or worse, what if he was lying? The dark possessed his mind for weeks. How the hell do we know he was telling the truth when he said they'd let him go? This spell of Ingold's is to cloak against a collective rather than an individual intelligence. But how do we know that will overcome the reason human magic never worked against the dark ones? What if it all was a trap? The unbearable terror returned again, as if some vast dark bulk were creeping slowly toward his back. But he could see nothing there, no movement in the stark white emptiness of the snow-covered meadow, and could hear no sounds but the hiss of his own breath in his lungs and the hot, too swift pounding of his heart. The years he'd spent on the fringes of the motorcycle gangs, among the tough guys and would-be tough guys of smog-bound Southern California, had given him a kind of bar-fight courage sufficient for his survival. But the waiting in terror for an unknown danger was different. His every perception sharpened by wizardry to detect what others found invisible was keyed to a fever pitch for the warning of danger. And in his heart, he was sure that no warning would save him. Cold, directionless winds breathed upon him, like the draft from a primordial abyss of darkness which had never seen light. At the touch of it, his heart seemed to lurch, then hammer chokingly. His intelligence screamed at his instinct to run, telling him that even if he ran, even if he made the half-mile dash through the ice-locked drifts of the buried meadow to the windowless keep of Dare, they would never let him in. Once the Cyclopean doors were sealed at sunset, keep law forbade that any should open them before dawn. So he drew the veils of alien illusion more firmly about him and prayed that they were right, Lohiro, Ingold, and Thoth, when they said that this kind of spell would guard his body from the inhuman hungers of the dark. He could feel the Dark Ones coming closer. He sensed their coming in the change of the air. Close by him, a little skiff of snow whirled up, as if stirred by wind, but no wind riffled now in the fur of his collar. In all directions, the snowy landscape rolled like a frozen silver sea. Yet, from the corner of his eye, he glimpsed movement, a sudden flurry that vanished, as things did in dreams. In the shadows of the trees before him, he thought he saw something shift, though not a branch stirred. They were all around him. He knew it, but their illusions screened them from his eyes as he prayed that his own covered him. He felt their stirring, though there was nothing that he could fix his eye upon, just a gleam of starlight on something that pulsed wetly in the sudden glitter of acid on chitinous claws. There was a buzzing, humming sensation in his brain, a drift of wind that stank of rotten blood. Then, suddenly, it was above him, a delirium vision of an obscene, squamous bulk, 15 feet from the tucked, slobbering tentacles of that drooling mouth to the wriggling tip of the spined cable of tail. Huge, clawed legs dangled down like the feet of a wasp. From them, acid dripped to smoke on the snow. Rudy shut his teeth hard on a scream. Sweat was freezing on his face, and every muscle in his body fought to remain still against the instincts that shrieked at him to run. The effort and the revulsion at the nearness of that filthy, dripping thing brought nausea burning to his throat. More than its evil, more than the terrible danger that breathed like smoke over him, he was filled with sickened loathing of its otherness, its utter alienness to the world of the visible, the material, the sane. Then it was gone. The wind of its departure kicked a stinging gust of snow over him as he slowly folded to his knees in the drifts. How long he knelt there in the darkness, he didn't know. He was trembling uncontrollably, his eyes shut, as if to blot out the memory of that hideous, slobbering bulk swimming against the stars. Stupidly, he recalled a night last spring, a warm California evening, when he and his sister had been headed down the harbor freeway in downtown Los Angeles, and the old Chevy had a blowout in the fast lane of the interchange. His sister had managed to pull the veering car under control, to force it out of the hammering madhouse of 60-mile-an-hour traffic and over onto the shoulder. Then she'd gotten out, calmly checked to see if the rim had been damaged, asked him if he was okay, and folded up on the car's steaming hood and gone into violent hysterics. Rudy suddenly found himself in sympathy with how she had felt. Something brushed his face, and he swung around, the cold searing his gasping lungs. Behind him stood Ingold Inglorian, looking quizzically down at him in the faint blue starlight.
"Are you all right?"
Rudy collapsed slowly back to a sitting position, his gloved hands pressed tightly together to lessen their shaking. He managed to stammer,
Yeah, fantastic. Just give me a minute. Then I'll go leap a tall building at a single bound.
The wizard knelt beside him, the full sleeves of his patched brown mantle brushing against him again, warm and rough and oddly reassuring. In spite of the cold, Ingold had pushed the mantle's hood back from his face, and his white hair and scrubby, close-clipped white beard gleamed like frost in the ghostly light.
You did very nicely, the old man said,
in a voice whose mellow beauty was overlaid by a grainy quality, scratchy without being harsh, and pitched as a wizard's voice could be for Rudy's ears alone.
Thanks, Rudy croaked shakily. But next time, I think I'll let you test out your own new spells.
The white eyebrows quirked. Ingold's face, as a whole, was totally nondescript, redeemed only by the heavy erosion of years and by the curious, uncannily youthful appearance of his eyes.
Well, I'm certainly not out here because it's the proper phase of the moon for harvesting slippery elm.
Rudy colored a little.
Scratch that,
he mumbled.
You shouldn't be out here at all, man. You're the one the Dark Ones have been after. All the more reason for me to come,
the old man said.
I can't remain walled in the keep forever. And if it is true, as I suspect, that somehow I hold the key to defeat the Dark Ones, at some time or another, I shall have to come forth and meet them. I had best assure myself of the efficacy of my cloaking spells before that time.
Rudy shivered, awed at the matter-of-fact calm in Ingold's tone. Rudy feared the Dark Ones, as all humankind must fear them, the eaters of the flesh and of the mind, the eldritch spawn of the hideous night below the ground, and arcane intelligence beyond human magic or human comprehension. But at least he was reasonably certain that they did not know him, his name, his essence. He knew that he was not the target of their specific malice. It was not his personal flesh they sought. He stammered,
But Christ, Ingold, you didn't have to come and check out the spell yourself. I mean, hell, if it works for me, it should work for you. Possibly,
Ingold agreed.
But that is something that no one can ever wholly know.
He drew his mantle closer about him. In the dim light, Rudy could see that the wizard was armed. The billowing folds of his outer garment broke over the long, hard line of the sword that he wore belted underneath. His right hand, in its faded blue mitten, was never far from the sword's grip-smoothed hilt.
Do you remember how?
He went on in his mild voice.
In the mazes of illusion that surrounded the city of Quo, you asked me once for a spell to break the wall of fog.
You told me the one I was using already would work just fine, Rudy recalled.
I can't say I was real pleased.
Calmly, the old man removed a speck of snow from his frayed sleeve.
If it is ever my aim to please you, Rudy, I shall certainly ask you what methods I should employ.
The gleam of mischief in his eyes turned his bearded face absurdly young.
But what I told you then was true. The strength of any spell is the strength of your magic, your spirit. Your power is shaped by your essence. You are your spells.
Rudy was silent, understanding this for the truth, as he had not understood it in the mazes of the trackless seaward mountains. It was the key to human magic, perhaps the key to all things human.
Do you feel sure of this spell, Rudy?
The wizard asked quietly.
Could you use it again?
Yeah,
Rudy said slowly, after long thought.
Yeah, I think so. I was scared to death, but...
But you kept your head,
Ingold said.
And you kept your hold over the spell.
Crusted frost gleamed in his scrubby beard as he nodded his head.
Do you think you could do so in the nest of the dark itself?
The thought was like a hypo filled with ice water, injected directly into Rudy's heart.
Christ, I don't know, it's...
Then he saw the intentness, the calculation in those crystal blue eyes.
Hey, you mean really in the nest of the dark? I mean, that wasn't just a hypothetical question.
The frost crackled a little as Ingold smiled.
Really, Rudy, you should know me well enough by this time to know that I seldom deal in hypotheses.
Yeah, Rudy agreed wearily. And that's probably the scariest thing about you.
It is the most frightening thing about any wizard. A hypothesis to anyone else is merely an overwhelming temptation to a wizard. Do you think you would be able to handle yourself in the nest of the dark?
Rudy swallowed hard.
I think so.
The vivid imagination, which was the main spring and curse of the mageborn, sent a series of chills scampering up his spine.
That's what this is all about, isn't it?
Ingold's eyes returned to focus from some private inner reverie. In the starlight, they seemed bright and preternaturally clear.
The Chancellor Alwyr cannot hope to reconquer Gay from the dark without reconnaissance of their nest there,
he said quietly.
He has chosen Gay partly because of its importance as the capital of the realm, and partly because it lies at the center of communications. But time is short. Our allies from the Empire of Alketch and from the various land chiefs of the realm will be assembling here in the not-too-distant future. You will be leaving for Gay within a day or so.
Okay,
Rudy agreed shakily, with valiant mental adjustments.
Just me?
Ingold snorted.
Yes, just you all by yourself,
he snapped gruffly.
Of course not. For one thing, Gay is a flooded ruin. You could never hope to find your way through its streets to reach the nest.
A drift of wind stirred his mantle and ruffled Rudy's long hair. Rudy's muscles locked at the touch of it, but he made no move. A moment later, he saw the flickering shadow of a little whirlwind dancing away over the snow. He let his breath out in a shimmer of silvery smoke.
Of the mages who survived the coming of the Dark Ones,
the wizard continued quietly,
less than a dozen have powers strong enough for me to have made this test on them. They, too, are abroad in the Vale tonight. Of those, only two hail from Gay. Sirlin, who was a healer in the lower part of town, and me.
Rudy nodded, He'd become acquainted in the last week with the other survivors of the world's wizardry. Sirlin was a fair-haired, rather nervous young man, a few years older than his own 25. He was unusual, not only in the fact that he wore spectacles, uncommon enough among mages, who could generally adjust their own senses and faculties, but also because he'd managed to preserve them unbroken on the long and desperate trek from Gay to the Vale of Renweth.
At one time, I considered leading the Gay reconnaissance myself,
the old man went on, and Rudy cast him a startled, protesting glance.
But aside from the fact that, as the head of the wizard's corps, I could ill be spared, I do take a rather academic and refined interest in the preservation of my own skill. Since the Dark are hunting me, for whatever reason, I would be in twice the danger of detection within the nest. It would be folly to tempt them.
It would be sort of pointless to get yourself killed on a routine mission,
Rudy admitted. Ingold smiled.
Precisely,
he agreed.
I'm sending Thoth to head the reconnaissance of Penumbra. He knows that city from his early days as a healer there. And I'm having the raider shaman, Shadow of the Moon, take a couple of scouts to the nest in the Vale of the Dark, some 20 miles north of here. She knows woodcraft, among other things.
In the black walls of woods to their right, branches stirred suddenly, rustling in dark, aimless winds. Clouds were moving down from the glacier-locked mountains that loomed above them to the west, swallowing the few remaining stars. Cold cut through Rudy's coat like a skinning knife.
Kara of Ipet will go with you and Sirlin to Gay,
Ingold went on.
She's had the most formal training as a mage, unless one counts the Chancellor Alwyr's court mage Bectis, of course.
Rudy sniffed. He did not like Bectis.
If he's out here tonight, I'll eat my boots without even scraping the mud off 'em.
If that's the case, I regret to inform you that you're going to miss a meal.
Ingold sighed.
Bectis knows Gay, too, but I'm sure that his ever-pressing duties will not permit.
He looked up suddenly, the words dying on his lips. A scream split the mountain's stillness, a hopeless, echoing shriek that scaled up to a frenzied pitch of horror, then jarred and broke. Rudy sprang to his feet, the hair prickling on his neck, and was instantly arrested by the iron grip on his arm.
Be still, you fool!
A figure broke from the edge of the woods on the far side of the valley, black and tiny against the hoarfrost landscape. A man, Rudy thought, watching the way he ran, young and slender, stumbling over his own cloak in his terrified haste. A swirl of darkness passed like a whirlwind over the snow. The fugitive screamed again as he ran, his arms outstretched, plunging blindly down the hill toward the black monolith of the Keep of Dare. Darkness swelled from the trees behind him, a strange shifting of images that even the dark sight of a wizard could not pierce. Something flashed, wet and sticky, and a last piercing cry rang out as if ripped from the dissolving flesh. Then there was silence, and something scattered over the half-melted snow. Even at this distance, Rudy could smell the blood on the backwash of the erratic winds.
Who was it?
Rudy asked. His voice was pitched low,
audible only to certain beasts or to another wizard. But still, his words sounded sacrilegiously loud in the horrible stillness of the hillside. Ingold straightened up from the sodden, stinking mess in the torn snow. Even the bones they had found had not only been stripped of flesh, but seemed strangely deformed, as if the bone tissue itself had been melted. Nauseated, Rudy looked away from the black, half-liquefied remains to Ingold's impassive face. Darkness masked the wizard's features, but mage-born eyes could penetrate ordinary night. Rudy could see no change of expression in that lined, nondescript countenance. But then, he supposed, after what had taken place in the ruins of the City of Wizards, it was not likely that the old man would ever be shaken up by much of anything again.
"We shall come out with the others when the sun is in the sky to burn what remains," Ingold said quietly. "To do so now would only bring the Dark Ones once more upon us."
He dropped what he held in his hand back onto the fetid little heap. Round, discolored lenses flashed in the starlight in their twisted frames. Ingold said,
"It seems that I shall be visiting the Dark Ones at Gay after all."
Dawn was just thinning the Stygian overcast of the night when Rudy and Ingold again reached the gates of the keep. Against a charcoal sky, the ebony mass reared like a small mountain. Close to 100 feet from the top of the rock knoll on which it stood to its flat, snow-powdered roof, and nearly half a mile in length, its black, windowless walls faintly mirrored the trampled snow and dark trees that lay below it. Only its western face was broken by a gate and a short flight of broad steps. From a distance, the torchlight flickering in the square opening gave it the appearance of a single, small, baleful eye in the midst of an otherwise utterly featureless face. As Rudy climbed the muddy path past the goat pens and ramshackle workshops that surrounded the keep in a vast zone of trash, he could see most of the wizard's corps assembled on the icy steps. He could pick out those who, like himself, had spent the night outside. Kara of Ipit, tall and homely, in her threadbare mantle, and the two cardigans her mother had recently knitted for her. Thoth the scribe, called the Serpent Mage, sole survivor of the massacre at Quo, austere as a bald vulture god of antiquity, his topaz eyes illuminating his narrow white face like a jack-o'-lantern's. Dacus the Minstrel, a little 14-year-old witch-child from the north called Elay, her dark eyes peering from behind a mane of red tangles. Others, a pitiful few, it seemed, huddled in the shadows like refugees in an old photograph of Ellis Island. And behind them stood those survivors of the massacre by the dark who had been judged too lacking in power to participate in this trial of spells. Itinerant conjurers, spell weavers, weather witches, and goody wives, the lower end of the spectrum of power that had not answered the dead Archmage's fatal summons to the City of Quo. Rudy's heart sank at the sight of them. "So few," he thought. "And what the hell can we do anyway against the might of the dark?" Other shadows appeared in the firelit tunnel that pierced the wall, leading from the outer gates to the inner, their forms ghost-like in the steam where the warmer air within came in contact with the outer cold. The day watch of the guards, rubbing their bruises from the morning's weapons practice, and cursing one another and their deceptively elfin instructor good-naturedly.
The keep herd kids went tearing out in an enthusiastic boiling of infant energy to throw snowballs and milk goats. Soap boilers, hunters, woodcutters, and tanners emerged, men and women plying what trades they could from the scanty resources of this bitter and isolated valley. And among them were a dark-haired girl in a black fur cloak and a peasant woman's rainbow skirts, and a tall, rather gawky woman, some 5 years older, dressed in an outsize black uniform and white quatrefoil emblem of the guards. Minalde brushed the sable hood from her dark hair as she ran down the steps to meet Rudy, the rich fur of her cloak rippling glossily in the gray light. In sunlight, her eyes were the unearthly blue of a volcanic lake on a midsummer afternoon. Shadowed as they were now, they were velvet blue, almost black, and wide with anxiety. She caught Rudy's hands.
"They told me they'd heard a scream," she said.
Rudy fought the urge to put a comforting arm around her shoulders, as he would have done had they met alone.
"She's the queen," he told himself, "the regent and the mother of the air for all. She's 19 years old and scared. There are too many people watching."
"Glad to see it wasn't you, punk,"
Gil Patterson added, bringing up the rear, her long sword tapping at her ankles as she walked. Since she had joined the guards of Gay, her former shy defensiveness had been gradually replaced by a toughness that, Rudy reflected, wasn't any easier to see through. Those pale schoolmarm's eyes still forbade any inquiries into the true state of her feelings, but she did look pleased that he'd survived. At his side, Alde whispered,
"Who was it?"
"Sirlin? I don't know if you knew him."
She nodded, tears starting in her eyes. Alde knew and was friends with almost everyone in the keep. Again, Rudy struggled with his instinct to hold her, to offer her silent reassurance.
"It puts us in a bad place," he admitted quietly, "when we go to scout the nest at Gay."
"You?"
Fear widened her eyes.
"But you can't."
She bit off her words, and a slow flush rose to her cheeks.
"That is, it isn't just for that," she added, with a soft-voiced dignity that made Rudy smile. "What about your experiments with the flamethrowers, Rudy? You said you'd be able to create weapons to hurl fire from the things that Gil and I found in the old laboratories. You can't..."
"They'll just have to wait," Rudy said quietly. "I'll put one together for myself to take to Gay. The rest can wait till I return."
He put his hands on her shoulders and smiled at her frightened, woebegone face.
"And I will return," he promised her.
She looked down, her eyes veiled, and she nodded. Gil's voice cut sharply into the silence between them.
"You think you'll really be able to put working flamethrowers together then?"
He looked up, startled at her tactlessness, and saw what she had seen. The tall form of the Chancellor of the Realm, Alwer, Minalde's brother, standing, watching them in the mist and firelight of the gates. Rudy backed quickly away from Alde and took a few steps up the path toward the keep.
"You bet,"
he bragged in his best Madison Avenue voice.
"Hell, in a month, we'll make swords obsolete."
"That would be to your advantage," Gil commented,
"since you can't pick one up without cutting yourself." But in spite of the banter, Rudy was acutely conscious of Alwer's cold gaze on him as he rejoined Ingold among the mages at the foot of the keep steps. Alwer came down toward them, a gleaming edifice of sartorial splendor, as Alde had once joked, dominating those around him with his size, his elegance, and his haughty, unbending will. Like his sister, he was cloaked in black, a velvet mantle that billowed like wings behind him, the chain of sapphires that lay over his broad shoulders and breast were not bluer or harder than his eyes. He was trailed by the obsequious Bectus, his court mage, who alternately rubbed his long white hands together or stroked his waist-length blue-silver beard, as if in a self-congratulatory caress. The Chancellor came to a halt on the lowest step and looked down at Ingold with an impassive face.
"So, your information was correct,"
he said in his rich, well-modulated voice.
"The thing can be done by those with the strength,"
Ingold returned quietly.
"Yes. And the reconnaissance? We shall leave this time tomorrow morning."
Alwer gave a satisfied little nod. Beyond them, the rising of the cloud-veiled sun had cast a kind of sickly, diffuse light upon the snowy wastes of the vale, bringing forth from shadows the tangled grubbiness of the barricaded food compounds and the chain-hung pillars on the hill of execution across the road from the keep.
"And these?"
The Chancellor's careless gesture took in the other mages. Old women, young men, solemn black southerners, and ice-white shamans from the plains.
"Believe me, my lord,"
Ingold said, and there was a flicker of anger in his shadowed eyes.
"Whether or not it is decided to undertake this invasion, these people constitute your chief defense against the Dark Ones. Do not treat them lightly."
Alwer's eyebrows went up.
"An unprepossessing lot,"
he commented, scanning them, and Rudy felt that those enigmatic, speedwell blue eyes lingered for a moment on where he had returned again to Alday's side.
"But perhaps more dangerous than they look."
"Far more dangerous, my lord."
The new voice drew Rudy's eyes, and half against his will, Alwer's as well. In the suffused pallor of the dawn, the guards on the steps had doused their torches in the snow, but within the gate passage above them, fires still reflected redly on the polished walls. Against that reflection stood the red-robed shape of the Bishop of Gay, Giovannin Narmenlion, her bald head and narrow, delicately jointed hands giving her the appearance of a skeleton wrapped in a crimson billow of flame.
"If you undertake your invasion using the devil's tools, my lord," she warned, in a voice as dry and deadly as famine winds, "they will be its downfall. They are excommunicates who have traded their souls to evil for the powers they possess."
Anger stained the big man's cheeks, but he kept the melodious calm of his voice.
"Perhaps if the straight faith were as dependent upon a centralized government as the realm is, you would be even at this moment showering them with blessings,"
he commented sardonically. The fine chiseled nostrils flared in amused scorn.
"Such words tell more about the speaker than they do about their subject,"
she remarked, and Alwer's flushed face reddened further.
"Better your precious invasion should fail than that you should bring yourself under the wrath of the church by harboring such as these, having commerce with the mageborn. The mage damned fouls the soul like clinging mud until all the faithful can see it and cast you out. Even to converse with them taints you.
Rudy felt Alday's icy fingers close over his, and glancing sidelong at her, he saw the shame struggling in her taut face. She had been a good daughter of the faith until the rainy night on the road from Karst, when he had found his power, and they had become lovers. Alwyr grated,
"That didn't prevent you from coming out to see how they had fared."
The bishop's dry voice was silky with menace.
"It pays to count one's enemies, my lord, Alwyr."
There was silence on the steps, save for the rising whine of the icy wind in the trees. The guards watched this confrontation uneasily. They had long grown used to the swift, vicious arguments between bishop and chancellor, but there was never any telling when one might suddenly escalate into civil war. Then, Alwyr's eyebrow canted mockingly.
"And do you count me so, my lady?"
"You."
The gray light slipped along the curve of her shaven skull as she looked him up and down, austere scorn in the curve of her delicate lips.
"You care not whether you are numbered among the godly or the wicked, my lord, as long as you can command what you call your niceties of life. You would sup in hell with the devil were the food good."
So saying, she turned in a swirl of scarlet and vanished into the darkness of the gate passage, her ringing footfalls dying away across the vast, empty spaces of the aisle beyond toward the dark mazes where the church kept unsleeping domain. Alday whispered,
"Rooney, I'm afraid of her."
Hidden by the folds of her heavy cloak, his hand pressed hers. Talk had surged up again around them. Two of the junior weather witches had been offering to send the coming snowstorm elsewhere until Sirlin's body could be burned, and Thoth's harsh academic voice was saying,
"To do so is to presume upon the laws of the cosmos that bid the winds blow where they will."
There was some argument, but all of them, with the exception of Ingold and a withered little hermit named Kta, were terrified of the scribe of Quo. Under cover of the talk, Rudy said softly,
"What can she do, babe? You're the queen. Even if she knew about us, which she doesn't, we aren't doing anyone any harm."
"No,"
she murmured, but her fingers trembled in his. Chapter 2 Ingold! Gil paused in the narrow doorway, all but invisible in the harlequin shadows that spangled the room. One of the other mages, the wizened little guru Kta, had told her that he was there, in a tiny chamber hidden deep within the secret levels of the keep, the subterranean levels of whose very existence 9 keep dwellers out of 10 were ignorant. Looking into the room, Gil saw that it was a miniature version of the observation chamber up on the second level, in whose stone and crystal table Rudy had once seen the possessed archmage from afar. Ingold was sitting on the edge of the circular black stone table, looking into the changeable brightness that flowed upward from its heart. He raised his head at the sound of her voice, his face checkered with light and shadow. Then he held out his hand to her, and the white light faded.
"I was on the point of sending for you," he said quietly,
as she took a seat on the table's edge beside him. Then, seeing the tautness of her mouth and the way her long, hilt-blistered fingers fidgeted with the buckle of her sword belt, he asked,
What is it, my dear?
Is it true what Rudy said? She demanded. That you're going to lead the reconnaissance to Gay? For a moment, he studied her in silence. It seemed to Gil that, as the cold brightness of the light faded, the lines of his battered face deepened momentarily.
After Sirlin's death, I am the only one who can lead it, he replied.
She cried in despair. You're going to be killed! At that, the blue eyes lightened. Ingold's smile was a curious thing, for it transformed him as sunlight could transform a highland landscape, making what was grim and angular suddenly young and wild.
You wound me, Gil,
he chided.
My very own cloaking spell.
This isn't a joking matter. In Gil, concern for others had always taken the form of anger. Her voice was rough and harsh as she spoke. The Dark Ones took Lohiro, and he was the goddamn Archmage.
Lohiro went with them willingly,
pointed out the man who had loved the Archmage as a son. Against the chill, shifting luminosity of the crystal's light, the scar he had taken in killing Lohiro stood out jaggedly raw on the flattened corner of his cheekbone.
Well, if they could hold him as their prisoner, Gil snapped, they sure as hell won't have any problems killing you.
An echo of that wild lightness still lingered in his eyes.
They'll have to catch me first.
Gil looked across the flickering fountain of light at him for a moment, struggling with anger and caring. Then she sighed, disarmed.
Well, all I've got to say to you is, you have the flakiest way of hiding out from them that I've ever seen, but that isn't any of my business.
Ah, Ingold smiled regretfully. But it is your business, Gil. I have rather effectively made it your business by bringing you to this world against your will and by getting you trapped here.
Gil shook her head.
That wasn't your fault. You couldn't have known the Dark Ones would try to get through the gap in the void.
It's kind of you to say so, but I should have reasoned it out earlier than I did.
Amid the darkness of the wall, his huge shadow stooped forward like a giant as he took her hand and drew her to his side.
I knew of the possibility, but at the time I rescued Prince Tyr, flight into your world seemed to be my only recourse, and I needed a confederate on the other side of the void. And believe me, it had been a grim lesson to me about the inadvisability of tampering with worlds beyond my own.
Gil shrugged. If you hadn't tampered, Rudy would still be painting bikes for the Hell's Angels. You can't say that was just coincidence.
I don't believe that there is such a thing as coincidence,
Ingold said. And for a moment, their eyes met.
And in any case,
he went on,
if I had not tampered, you would not have been dragged from the life you were working to build for yourself at the university, your research, and your friends. If it had not been for the danger that the dark could follow you back across the void and devastate your world as it has destroyed ours, you would have returned to all that long ago. And that, my dear,
he concluded quietly,
is why I came here tonight.
He drew her forward. Light pulsed suddenly in the crystal inset in the table's center, bathing them in a white kaleidoscope of brightness.
Look into the crystal, Gil.
She obeyed him, bending over it and blinking against that coruscating glare.
I don't understand, she stammered.
The brightness drew her sight, blinding her to the room, the shadows, and the robed figure at her side. Though there was a silence, she felt as if she were looking at music. Only the faint buzzing throb of the machinery in the nearby pump rooms broke the utter stillness of the vision in which she was caught.
It is not easy to explain,
that deep, grainy voice at her side said.
This observation chamber, like the one up on the second level, was originally built to monitor the defenses of the keep, a logical expedient considering the miles of corridor involved. But, as Rudy learned, magic crystals have many uses. What you are seeing now is a construct, a simple visible expression of ideas too vast to be comprehended by ordinary means.
Gil frowned as her eyes slowly adjusted to the brilliance of that river of light that seemed to pour up around her. For a time, she was not certain that she even saw what she thought she saw, for she had no consciousness of the crystal itself. She thought that she looked down through an infinity of space, bathed in burning whiteness, and that, like bubbles in shining solution, gold spheres were moving, circling one another in the slow patterns of an unknowable dance. Their opalescent surfaces swam with colors that she neither recognized nor comprehended, revealing stars, galaxies, ages, cosmic vistas of something that was neither space nor time. The spheres grew infinitely smaller with distance, though there was neither horizon nor wall to break her line of sight. As far as she could see in that blazing ether, they were moving, merging, parting, and drifting around one another in endless patterns whose meaning whispered at the verges of her understanding. They shimmered like oiled gold as they touched, pressed together like the hands of joining dancers in those veils of light, and then, with infinite slowness, parted. Ingold spoke again, his words seeming to her to come from some great distance.
What you see is the void, Gil, the void between universes, the void that you crossed to come here. The spheres are worlds, universes, eons of time, each one a limitless cosmos of matter and energy, entropy and life. This is the closest I can come to explaining it to you, and it bears about as much relationship to reality as a child's 5-point drawing bears to the wonder and complexity that is an actual star. Do you see the joined spheres that lie closest to us?
She nodded.
Are they? They look as if they're moving apart.
So they are,
he murmured.
They are your world and mine, Gil. Last summer, they had been drifting together until they lay so close that the curtain between them thinned. It is possible for one who understands the nature of the void, as I do, to travel from this world to any other. But on that night that I first spoke to you, in the courtyards of Gay, at the first quarter moon of autumn, they lay so close that a sleeper, a dreamer, could be drawn across unknowingly, as you were. It is this closeness that has prevented me from sending you back, for any rent in the tenuous fabric that divides your world from mine would set off a series of gaps through which the Dark Ones could find their way, as, in fact, one did. But our worlds are parting, drifting out of their cosmic conjunction. In 6 weeks or so, at the time of the winter feast, it will be safe for me to open the gate in the void and return you to your world without endangering the civilization that gave you birth.
When he spoke of her return, she looked quickly up from that shining well to meet his eyes.
And that, my dear, is why I am here tonight,
he repeated as gently as he could.
For you are right. I do not know what awaits me in Gay. Danger, certainly, and perhaps my death. I had hoped to return you to your own world tonight, lest you should be trapped here forever.
Gil whispered, "Tonight?" She was shocked at the suddenness of it. The fact that she might eat her dinner in the bleak Vale of Renwith and finish the evening with a midnight snack at a cafe on Westwood Boulevard. Indefinable emotions beat upon her, and she could only stare at him with blank, startled, stinging eyes. Ingold took her hands gently and said,
"I am sorry, Gil. Was that why you sought me out?"
She could not reply. Beside her, his voice went on.
"Since the night the Dark Ones tried and failed to break the gates of the keep, you know that they have haunted the Vale of Renwith. It may be that they are waiting for our guard to slacken, or that they look for the opportunity to trap me outside the walls. But it could be that they are waiting for me to tamper again with the fabric of the universe, to open a gate through the void. And that I dare not do."
Still, she remained silent. Below her, the crystal had gone dark, and the room was drowned in shadow. But it seemed to her that she could still see vague infinities of dark spheres and the suggestion of slow, turning movement through blackness. Quietly, she said,
"It's all right."
His hands rested upon her shoulders, warm and comforting, banishing fear, as they always had the power to do.
"I am sorry,"
he said again.
"It isn't that."
Out of the darkness that surrounded them, a faint thread of bluish light flickered into being. As Ingold helped her to her feet, the gleam widened and strengthened, showing the room small, black, and Spartan. The crystal plug set in the center of the table, opaque and sparkling, a faint and frosted gray. The light drifted along above Ingold's head, and their shadows lumbered, black and sprawling, about their feet as they went through the narrow door. It illuminated the gray fog of dust stirred by their feet as they passed through the deserted corridors of the empty hydroponics chambers. It winked on the disassembled components of flamethrowers beyond the shadowed doorway of Rudy's laboratory. Like a vagrant ball of foxfire, it preceded them up the narrow stair to the inhabited levels of the keep and through the dark succession of closets, doorways, and interconnecting halls that made up the headquarters of the Wizards Corps. The Corps' common room was deserted, its only light, the dim apricot glow that pulsed from the embers that lay like a heap of jewels on the wide hearth. Their two shadows moved clumsily through the greater darkness of that long room, passing
like the shadows of clouds, over the paraphernalia of habitation there. The jewel-bound books salvaged from the wreck of Quo, or shamelessly stolen from the archives of the church. Kara of Ippet's satin pincushion, sparkling like a diamond hedgehog among a great tumble of homespun cloth. The knuckly, knobby braids of herbs and onions hanging above the hearth. And the silver rainfall that was the strings of Rudy's harp. The round gold eyes of the headquarters cats flashed at them from every gloomy corner. Ingold sighed, breaking his bitter silence. And there was a note in his voice that she had never heard before.
I had never meant to put you in such peril, Gil. It is said that wizards, among their many faults, have a horrible way of endangering their friends. I only hope to get you safely away from here, back to your own world, before disaster strikes. Those who are close to me seem to have a shocking rate of mortality.
The beaten regret in his voice shocked her. That isn't true, she said. In the darkness, he was only a darker shape, edged with the tawny colors of the fire.
You think not?
With his face hidden, the pain and irony of his words sounded all the clearer.
Rudy has inherited the staff of one of my dearest friends, child, and the widow of another.
That has nothing to do with you.
No.
Like a spark rising, his eyebrow was tipped with reflected gold.
One of them I deserted in the hour of his death. Another I killed with my own hands. I don't see how much more I could have had to do with it.
Either of them would have commanded you to do what you did, and you know it. When he tried to turn away from her, she caught at his robe, the rough homespun bunched in her fist. You were all trapped together by forces you couldn't control, she whispered savagely. Don't torture yourself because you were the survivor. Still, he was silent, except for the thick draw of his breath. In the fading ember light, he was only a dim shape to her. But she was aware of him as she had never been aware of anyone or anything in her life. The touch of the patched wool clenched in her hand. The scent of sweet herbs and soap and wood smoke that permeated the cloth. The stippling of fire outlining the edge of his white hair. With a heightened consciousness, she felt that she would have known him anywhere, without sight or hearing, merely by his nearness alone. When he raised his fingers to touch her wrist, she felt like it was an electric shock. In a softer voice, she said, Quit tearing at yourself, Ingold. None of it was your fault.
But your death here would be.
Do you think that matters to me?
It matters to me.
Then, suddenly, her hand was empty. She heard the dry swishing of the curtain that covered the door of the alcove where he slept. But her eyes could not pierce the gloom at the end of the room. His grainy voice came to her as a disembodied murmur from the shadows.
Good night, Gil, and goodbye. Forgive me if I should not return from Gay.
Elsewhere in the keep, other goodbyes had been said. The hour was late. Rudy thought he had heard the changing of the deep night watch some time ago. But though he was more aware than most people of the span of time that had elapsed since then, it cost him conscious effort to translate it mentally into hours and minutes. He knew, in one sense,
that it was 2:30 or so in the morning. But this was something that had lost its importance. He had lost his impulse to check the time, just as he no longer automatically felt for a light switch when he walked through a door. The calling of light was an easy matter, like whistling. Seeing in the dark was easier still. He trod the lightless corridors of the second level soundlessly, taking his memorized turnings as surely as he had once known that you get off the San Bernardino Freeway at Waterman Avenue. And two right turns got you to Wild David Wild's Paint and Body Shop. He threaded his way along a black, dusty passage between the cells that housed Alware's private guards and a storeroom where he was sure the Chancellor was illegally storing undeclared food for one of his merchant buddies. He passed through a closet-like cell that had been partitioned off an old scriptorium and turned down a cutoff through a dark, disused latrine. Alde had shown him this route after he'd returned from Quo. It was the quickest way from the Wizard's Corps Commons to her rooms, allowing for a detour to avoid church territory. Alde and Gil had spent weeks exploring the keep, digging out the mysteries of its building, and either of them could get through the Stygian warrens of jerry-built walls, spiraling mazes of old brick and grimy plaster, and up and down the drunken spiderweb stairways with the swift, unthinking ease of a second grader getting through the Pledge of Allegiance. As for the mysteries whose answers they had sought, they had uncovered no answers, but only more mysteries. They had found fuel-less, everlasting lamps, and the component parts of flamethrowers. They had found the ancient machinery that the keep's builders, the wizard engineers, had used to power the air and water pumps. They had found riddles as enigmatic as the frosted gray polyhedron crystals that littered the lower labs in such useless numbers. But they had discovered no evidence that the vast hydroponics gardens had ever been used, no records of the early days of the keep, and no sign of how the wizard engineers had so suddenly vanished. There was no evidence of how Dare of Renwith, builder of the keep and founder of the line of High Kings, had defeated the Dark. Nothing at all as to why the Dark Ones had ceased their ancient depredations upon humankind and returned to the black abyss that had spawned them. Rudy stepped cautiously around an oblique corner and through a dark complex of cells where, even at this late hour, a soft flicker of greasy yellow lamplight winked through a crack in a door, and quarreling voices brushed his awareness like wind as he passed. Rodent eyes sparkled redly at him from the murk. Somewhere, a chicken clucked loudly, followed by the sodden thump of a thrown boot. Had it been the flamethrowers that defeated the Dark? He didn't think so. The pieces he'd found in the labs were few and incomplete. Besides, the Dark had been around for centuries after Dare's time. Had some other champion of humankind arisen? Some other warrior who had dealt the Dark Ones so crippling a blow as to render them unwilling to continue the attack? How had humankind defeated the Dark? The question is the answer, Ingold always said. The question is always the answer. But Rudy had cudgeled his brains over all possible answers and had found himself faced with only that question. Maybe Tyr would remember how. Maybe his father Eldor would have remembered eventually, had he not perished in the blazing ruin of the palace at Gay. Though Tyr was yet too young to speak, the baby prince gave evidence of having inherited that terrible and mysterious legacy common among the descendants of Dare of Renwith, not only from his father, but by carrier, as it were, from Minalde as well. Her memories were vague, recognition rather than recall. But if the flamethrowers were the answer, wouldn't she have known it? And if not the flamethrowers, what? White light gleamed palely before Rudy, reflecting against the slick black stone of the walls. He passed the head of one of the main stairways of the keep, its smooth construction announcing that it had been built at the time of the founding of that colossal maze itself. In a cage over it hung a single glowstone, a warning to the unwary. How else had humankind defeated the dark? Had the wizard engineers stood at the top of those hellish stairways that led down to their hideous domains and dumped barrels of glowstones into the chasm? Unlikely. Early experiments had shown that sufficient numbers of the dark ones could damp the light of glowstones, just as they killed fires or sucked the strength from a wizard's spell of light. Some other weapon, buried in the deeps of time? Something Ingold might have learned of in his years of study and wandering. Some piece of knowledge that lay like an unexploded bomb in the depths of that complex mind? Rudy would have swapped several of his younger siblings for the answer to that one. A drift of warmer air rose from the stairway, stirring his long hair. It bore on it the soft, musical chanting of the night offices of the church, and Rudy turned away, uneasy at the thought of the minor empire that filled the first-level warrens around that fluted sanctuary. He had heard too many tales from the other mages in the corps, rumors of rooms where magic would not operate, and where a wizard could be imprisoned, as Ingold had been imprisoned in the doorless cell of Karst. There were whispers of black magic or such things as the rune of the chain, which bound and crippled a wizard's power and left him helpless to his ancient ecclesiastical foes. Rudy had seen the rune of the chain. The memory was not a pleasant one. He turned down another corridor, past a guardroom where voices hummed above the rattle of a dice cup. For a moment, the haughty, intolerant face of Bishop Giovannin floated through his memory, as he had seen her in the dawn light on the steps. It pays to count one's enemies. There was one he sure as hell didn't need a magnifying glass to find. But what, after all, could she do? He found what he'd been seeking, a jury-rigged ladder-like stairway leading down to a back corridor of the level below, at a healthy distance from the church. Not even a glowstone marked it, for few people came this way. Below lay only a chasm of darkness, stinking of dust and mice. The crazy rungs creaked under his weight. Steadying himself against the splintery wood, he jumped the last few feet to the floor. It was only when he landed that he saw movement. His wizard's sight caught the glint of velvet and jewels. Then, as faint as a whiff of the orris root perfume, he heard the unmistakable clink of a sword hilt on a belt buckle and the slurring whisper of a heavy cloak. A rich, mellow voice spoke from the shadows.
"Don't be so apprehensive, my dear boy. I have no intention of doing you harm."
Rudy let his breath out slowly.
"That's nice to know,"
he remarked.
"I mean, you know, halfway through the deep night watch, you kind of wonder about the people you meet wandering around the back corridors."
"Indeed you do."
Alwyr opened a single pane of the lantern he bore, and dim, dappled white light filtered through the fretwork slides that surrounded the enchanted stone within.
"You have let Ingold make you suspicious."
He set the lantern on a ledge of projecting bricks and turned back to face Rudy, his handsome, fleshy face, very white within the raven masses of his hair.
Yes, he continued, one cannot but wonder about those who walk in the night.
Rudy realized, with a sudden chill in the pit of his stomach, that Alwer had been waiting for him. There was nothing that he could possibly reply. The smell of Minalde's perfume clung to his clothes. On the last night before we split, he thought, Alwer knew he'd be able to intercept me. Not that he'd have had much problem any other night since we got back from Quo. Rudy wiped his clammy hands on his breeches and waited in silence for what Alde's brother would say.
They tell me you've made excellent progress in the arts of magic,
Alwer went on in a conversational tone.
Your work on the flamethrowers will, of course, be invaluable to us when we march against the dark. Is it your belief that Dare of Renwith used something of the kind to invade the nests?
Rudy swallowed, put off balance by the small talk, but unable to do anything except play along.
I don't know. We've never even found evidence that Dare did invade the nests.
Oh, come,
Alwer chided patronizingly.
We both know he must have done so. The Dark were defeated somehow. I feel sure that your reconnaissance to Gay will reveal to us exactly how it was done, and how we, allied with the armies of Alketch, may do likewise.
Yeah,
Rudy said warily, still trying to understand this cat-and-mouse game.
There are good odds, anyway.
Alwer's smile was wide and false and cold, like something he'd stapled on.
And afterward?
If I'm alive afterward,
Rudy replied, picking his words carefully.
We'll see.
Indeed.
Alwer was still smiling, but the lobelia blue eyes would have scratched diamonds. As if to change the subject, he said,
I assume your liaison with my sister is a well-kept secret? Not that I don't understand her feelings,
he hastened to add, cutting off Rudy's flaring words.
After all, she is young and lonely. She was grateful to you for saving her son's life, as we were all, of course. And she could hardly have fallen in love with Gil or Ingold,
he sighed.
I would have prevented this if I could have, but the affair seems to have begun behind my back and was, I believe, well advanced by the time we arrived here. Was it not?
His voice strained. Rudy asked,
What do you want?
My dear young friend,
the Chancellor sighed, his face never losing that determined smile.
I am not trying to trap you, but a man has a right to do a little plain speaking with the man who is lying with his sister. I wonder if you have considered the consequences to her.
When Rudy made no reply, Alwer shook his head with mingled patience and disappointment.
Presumably, as a wizard, you can prevent her conceiving by you. Or, if that hasn't occurred to you, I assume that she can get advice from her women friends among the guards. And as far as I know, my sister was quite faithful to poor Eldor. And Altir is indeed the late king's child.
As far as you know?
Rudy lashed, furious at the insult.
She worshipped him, damn it.
and mourned him intensely, I'm sure.
Alwyr purred. Rudy felt his face redden. Alwyr went on.
It would be putting it mildly indeed to say that her reputation would suffer were the news to come out among the people that their queen was less than 2 weeks replacing their worshipped lord in her bed. I could probably protect her from actual harm,
he mused,
but without a doubt, she would be excommunicated.
Giovannin's fanatic eyes seemed to glitter before Rudy. He swallowed.
You couldn't.
Alwyr's curved eyebrows lifted.
For lying with a wizard? In the south, she would be burned for it.
Rudy stared at him in shock.
You're kidding.
Don't treat yourself to false comfort at her expense,
the Chancellor told him mildly.
If the scandal became open, she would certainly be excommunicated and, as such, would no longer be able to hold the regency or to have custody of her son.
The words fell on Rudy's ears, without meaning at first. Then understanding came, and the slow kindling of fury deep within him. He was surprised at how steady his own voice sounded.
Which you would get.
Of course.
Alwyr sounded amazed that there would be any question. He laid a patronizing hand on Rudy's shoulder.
Believe me,
he went on, his voice low and grave.
I have no desire to create such a scandal.
Through his teeth, Rudy said,
That's nice.
I am quite fond of Minalde, you know. She's a dear child for all she's headstrong, and I admit to a certain weakness for pretty young girls.
Rudy remembered the agonies of remorse Alday had passed through, fighting her instinctive loyalty to her brother, and the disillusionment that stemmed from the strength of her love for him. He found himself literally trembling with rage, overwhelmed with a primal urge to smash the smirking big man's teeth down his throat. Not that that would help Alday any. Alwyr continued pleasantly. But you see.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.